Mr. S.N. Piran and his wife. And they are very close friend, Mr. T.K. Jayaraman. So, welcome you all to our centers. Now, one interesting thing I would like to share with you all is Mr. Piran is my husband's classmate. And I have met him after 35 years. And my husband used to tell me to invite him here because he gives very good lectures. So I said, I've been planning for the past 2 months and it just happened now. Now I invite Mr. Jayaraman to give a small introduction about Mr. Piran.
Thank you, madam. I am extremely very happy to be amongst all of you on this wonderful morning. Of course, Bangalore's weather was very severe for the past few days, but yesterday this rain has really brought much cheers to us. I stay in Malleshwaram only. It's just I want to tell you about myself one or two lines.
And 1 minute, sorry to disturb you.
Yes.
But he is going to come one of these days to give us a talk also.
Okay, thank you. I belong to the Indian Revenue Service, the Customs and Central Excise. So I worked in various places in India. I was Commissioner of Customs. Then later I joined the tribunal as a member. The Customs Excise Service Tax Tribunal. I became a technical member and my first colleague in the tribunal was Mr. Piran. Dr. Piran, he actually got a doctorate in English literature. He is a very prolific writer and a very interesting man. And I really enjoyed 5 years of my stint in the tribunal with him. After our court hours, we used to sit together and we could discuss any subject, whether it is the Hindu mysticism or Islamic mysticism or the modern science, theory of relativity, how science and religion go together. Yeah, the field is open for us. He's a very widely read man and a person who takes keen interest in all things spiritual and intellectual. So I really had great fortune to be in his company for such a long time. He writes beautifully in English. He is a poet. Actually, his doctorate is given by one of the international universities for his contribution to English poetry. He has published a lot. 11, I think he has brought, 11 most of the 11 volumes of poetry books he has published.
One book on Sufism.
And a book on Sufism. And he deals with all aspects of life. I mean, he's a very keen observer of events, our, ordinary daily life and all the things which go beneath it, our ideals, our hypocrisies, our ways of life, the situation in the country, nothing escapes his attention. So, it's really, you can peruse any one of the books. Yes, and you will find a lot of, it will be really a feast for your intellect. And he is also the editor of the Sufi World, and it is being published the last 3 years.
5 years.
It's being published for the last 5 years. They are very wonderful issues, where he has, extracted the gems of Islamic mysticism, Sufi mysticism, and he gives all his commentaries. Now, I think I should not stand much between him and you. So, I request Dr. Piran, to give his talk on Sufism. Thank you, madam, for giving me this opportunity to introduce my wonderful colleague. Thank you.
Namaste and pranams to all elders and seniors. I have the good fortune.
You can sit and talk if you want.
Yeah.
For some time,
You can sit and talk. Depending on whether you are in the bar or the bench, stand up on the bench.
I begin in the name of the Lord, the most beneficent and the merciful, for whom we seek all our help, doing all our despondencies, cheer and happiness. He is the most gracious and the most loving, the Lord of the universe, to whom we seek all help, to whom we bow down. And this is the main theme on beginning of man and God relationship. I would like to give a small introduction before I go to the subject of Sufism and how Sufism has come into existence from primordial times. Before I could go into that, I would like to read a small introduction which would be a preface to the work. I have been invited to address the elders and senior citizens. I have neither the expertise, nor experience, nor knowledge, nor standing to speak to such an illustrious and august assembly. I have not been a public figure either. My only credential is that of an Indian writing in English poetry, an Indo-Angelian poet. I have a background of Sufism, for I belong to an illustrious family practicing the values of Sufism for centuries. I have been initiated and imbibed in that culture. However much I may claim my associationship with Sufism and Sufis, I am not an adept. Adept is a guru or an expert, despite the fact that I edit a journal on Sufism, that is Sufi world, for the last 5 years for International Sufi Center. I have crossed my 60th year, and with these credentials I can say that I am retired from public and civil life, and that I can dare share my experience of entering the old age and problems and challenges associated with it. I had the good fortune to do post-graduation in social service and administration along with Shaila's husband D.L.N. Rao, who was a rank holder and I was a backbencher, for four decades ago. As part of our curriculum, we were required to present a dissertation on social problem. I chose the study of life of old people over 60 years in an old age home. St. Joseph's Age for the Old Age Home at Hussur Road, started by Mother Teresa. As it was felt by my professor guide that in few decades from then, due to change of lifestyle, breakdown of joint family system and immigration of young people to foreign countries, aged people were bound to face many social challenges. My study did disclose this stark reality, and the future for aged people was not rosy due to the social changes anticipated. And it has been proved right. Now after 40 years, when I have reached the 60th year of my life, I am faced with that reality in as much as I am no longer the head of a large growing family, but a lone person watching walls and counting and telling beads and rosary day in and day out, for my children have left me for foreign countries in search of greener pastures. Fortunately, I am blessed with a good pension and secured by medical aid from the government, being a retired government servant. But I have no more joys to share with new growing generation. I have no role to play in passing the ancient culture. I am a mere witness to cultural decay and degeneration. I can empathize with you all faced with a situation like mine. Those of you who are in old traditions, surrounded by children and grandchildren, you are all blessed, fortunate and most favored persons from the Lord. Count your blessings, says the Holy Scriptures, and this one is the best blessing showered by Lord Almighty. Nothing can bring more fortune than this lucky phase of your life. Each day is a day of blessing, and each moment is a moment of joy and happiness. But for those who are in my bandwagon, I can only share my thoughts of a Sufi way of life, which counts on being in merger with the Lord Almighty, who feels, a Sufi feels, his presence always. And such a presence is a mighty grace, is a greater blessing of bliss, ecstasy and joy. You can share your love and happiness with those who are not fortunate in life in many, many ways. Like a lamp, you can spread the light around, and with the torch which Lord has blessed you, you can find new ways to brighten the pathways of less fortunate. I would like to share my feelings on reaching my 60th year, penned by me in one of my poems. The poem is titled Eternal Peace. For 60 long years, I had to climb the steep cliff, slipping, falling, struggle after struggle. At last, conquered the summit, the point that touches the sky, and where I hoisted my flag. I could take a deep breath to review the pleasant view, scenery from the top of the mountain. Ah, what a wonderful sight, exquisite and marvelous beyond my imagination, breathless beauty in all its splendor, glorious and wonderful. Now my climb down would be in a moment. No more aspirations, no more struggles, no more adventures, no more hopes, no more dreams. A deep silence, a quietude, a great merger for eternal peace. Now, what is this Sufism? Sufism is nothing but all about silence and to attempt sincerely with all humility at one's command to reach and merge with the Lord, the gracious and the loving. Now what Sufism can offer and what exactly is Sufism is what is the next chapter which I am dealing about. What Sufism can offer and give to those who have reached the true light zone and are in the evening of their life, after having felt the mirth and pleasure, the humdrum of the life. To quote a famous Sufi poet Umar Khayyam, whom you must have read, Rubaiyat of Umar Khayyam. Umar Khayyam was one of the greatest Sufi, an astronomer, a mathematician, and he had a great insight into the aspect of inner consciousness. And the Edmund Fitzgerald, who translated the poems, thought that these poems which he talks about love, wine and woman, meant something to do with mirth and pleasure. But wine and woman was a metaphor to the intoxication which you have when you are in great merger with the Lord. And in that connection, he was always trying to emphasize that each moment of your life is more precious than the past or the future. And he put that thing in a beautiful couplet which is memorized by almost every one of us who have read the English literature. And he calls upon the beloved, the Lord. Ah, my beloved, fill the cup that cheers, fill the cup that clears today of past regrets and future fears. Unborn tomorrow, dead yesterday, why fret about them when today be sweet? This is his meaning. What he wants to say is, for a Sufi, each and every moment is precious. You call it a Sufi, you call it a yogi, you call it a mystic, you call it a man who is totally in joy and pleasure, who has given up the attachments to the world. Lord Buddha says that all miseries which he wanted to realize as to why man becomes old. When he was young, was born, it was predicted that he would become a great personality and he will give up his world and his fortunes and his throne. So he was advised, his parents were advised, that he should not see any dead person. He should not move with the people because that will move him. It did happen after the marriage when he saw a dead body. He was puzzled. I said, what is this? What is this old age? So he was so much moved, he abandoned his throne, abandoned his wife, abandoned his single child, and left to the village to sit below the tree to contemplate. And what did he achieve? What he achieved was that he realized that all these pains and sorrows and difficulties of life are due to the attachments which we have towards our desires and to our ahankara and ego. And once we shed this, we have shed the coil of life and we are free from the burdens of the life, free from the frustrations and the anger and the ego and the jealousy and all that is associated with it. So he gave this thought of moksha in your life itself if you have relinquished your desires and egos and ahankara. This is what was the main theme of Buddhism, which was not something which was new. It was what was discovered in the Upanishads. It was what was discovered by the Vedas. It was what was discovered in the Rig Vedas. All those who had attained the heights of glory in the spiritual attainments did realize that it is the inner I. It is the inner I. I am the man. This I has two facets. The I of your own self, which has been born along with you, which as a human being, you are nothing but a product of evolution. You are an animal and you carried within you the animal instincts, the animal consciousness. And later, it is the development of the human consciousness, the ages, the man realized that he has to give up this fear, fear of the unknown, fear of the harm, fear of insecurity. Then he developed in his consciousness what is known as moral fear and courage of conviction, which he passed on to the generations after generations. Later on, he realized that after looking into the various signs of the nature, looking into the signs of all that which is around him, that the real truth lies somewhere else. And the truth I have to reach. And the truth ultimately is Satya Jayate. So he realized the truth. And the truth was something which is not hidden. It is something which is in his own inner eye. When people went to Ramana Maharishi, a great saint in Red Hills, and asked him as to what and how one can reach the truth, he would say, look into your own self. Understanding your own inner consciousness leads you to the light which is hidden in the heart. Now, we have to give a little introduction as to why we think of a personality greater than us. A personality greater than us is something which is imbibed in our heart and mind through our consciousness when we were born. First, our attention was towards our mother, where we were able to suckle the milk, and we wanted the security, the warmth, the affection, the love of the mother. The love of the mother is a symbol in Sufism to say that the love of the mother is the love of the Lord, and the Lord's love is 70 times to 90 times more. It is a metaphorically said 70, it means millions of times. When you look around, we find that there is blessings and blessings and blessings. And the fact that we are getting the oxygen, we are getting so much protection from various harms, from the animals, from insects, from x-rays, from the cosmic rays and various other things is nothing. But the system is working in such a way that the protection is imbibed within our consciousness itself. And the consciousness itself takes care to protect and give us the solace, the peace, the bliss, the ecstasy. This is what was realized by the great souls. And this, how after realization of this by the great souls, they passed on to the generations after generation that the higher intellect, the higher knowledge is something which is unconnected with the animal instinct which you have, that is the lust, that is the anger, that is the jealousy, that is the capriciousness, that is the aspect pertaining to hatred, the enmity. All these things are nothing but which man has acquired to safeguard his own soul, to safeguard his body, to safeguard his wife, to safeguard his property. But in fact, these are all material things, and this is materialism has to be shed like a coil by the snake so that he can come towards the higher thinking, a higher evolution where he finds love, charity, humility, sincerity and such great qualities which are already imbibed into the man. The Christian civilization, the Jewish civilization gave birth to the Islamic civilization. Islamic civilization is nothing but a fulfillment of all the ideas which had come from the Judaic thoughts and the Christian thoughts. The whole Quran is nothing but a completion of the work which according to the Prophet was incomplete with the Christians and the Jews. When the God thought of creating, what the philosophy is, that man was, God was hidden, a secret. And he wanted to expose himself and see. And he did by thinking that he can create a man in his own image. This is the philosophy. He created it by grinding the sand, mixture of sand, fire, dust, water, and so many elements which we have discovered. There are 99 elements which we have within us. He made it, and then before he could put his spirit, he asked all the angels to go down and give respect to this particular idol which he had made out of sand and water and fire. The angels were nothing but light and eminence. They questioned the Lord as to why you have made this idol, this man who is nothing but a niggard, a person who is going to fight among himself with hatred and jealousy and lust and all other bad qualities. Lord pronounced that I know better than what you do, what you know. I know what I am saying. You bow down. Because they were unable to see that this idol of man was to comprise the element of the Lord himself and his spirit which was going to blow in it. But the archangel, the head of the angels, is supposed to have revolted and said, I am not going to bow down before this dust and water. I am fire, I can burn it. I am light, I am eminent, I am the head. I have been doing this service to you for millions of years, and this wretched thing which is going to create bloodshed and murder, you want me to subjugate myself? No, I am not going to do. God said, I know better than what you do. Then he took permission that he said, you are banished from the heaven. If I am banished from the heaven, give me the chance to at every moment and every second of the life to disturb this creature, to see that this creature is astray, goes astray, does not believe in you, does not bow down before you, does not bow down to your commands, does not keep up the commands, does not maintain the quietness, does not maintain the stillness, does not maintain the harmony, does not maintain the cosmic balance, and he attempts to live a life of impunity, and something which is wretched and something which is shunned. The God said, go, do what you like. But he was scared. He pronounced that I shall not be able to go near a person who is humble to you, sincere to you, who is totally subjugated to you. I will not be able to go near him. So this is the philosophy which the Christian civilization, the Judaic and the Islamic civilization has laid down. That is the humility and the simplicity of a man, which is the first lesson of wisdom. If you have acquired the simplicity, humility, and the nature of submitting yourself to the higher ego, the higher aspects which are governing the universe, you are entering the path of knowledge. You are entering the path of higher thoughts, and moksha will come to you. Peace will come to you. Tranquility will come to you. So, solace will come to you. This is what the Lord said. And from there, but he gave a test to the Adam which he had created after creating Eve from his rib, that you shall not eat the fruit. This is my command. Beware of this enemy, the Satan, the accursed, who is going to disturb you. It so happened he was trying to disturb the Adam. Adam was above all that. He could not be disturbed. He went to Eve. This is what the scriptures speak. The Eve was able to convince that if you take the fruit, you will attain immortality. This is what has been brought out in the beautiful poem, epic poem by John Mintel in Paradise Lost and Paradise Regained. Now here, the Satan succeeded, and when they ate the fruit, all their karma which was there, the inner impurity which was there, already imbibed, it grew into flux and overcome them, and they were able to exhaust themselves into the act of copulation, which we have made them impure. And the Lord said, you are banished from my land, and he landed them into the earth with all the material possessions. The heaven is bereft of all the bad things, and the earth is supposed to be the place where the man was sent so that he can cross through the tests and trials and tribulations. And after he has purified himself from all the things which he has carried, of the dust, the air, the fire, the water, the impurities which he has, so that the light in his mind and heart can glow. This is why the Brahmins who are here may be aware that the forefathers give them to recite this Gayatri Mantra. The Gayatri Mantra is nothing which calls upon the Lord Mother to banish the darkness from the heart so that enlightenment can come to them. So whether you are a Hindu or a Muslim or a Christian or a Jew or a Buddhist, you have realized that there is a preeminence, there is a great Lord, there is someone who has created us, and we have to go back to him. From him we have come, and to him we shall return. When we return to him, we return with a purified heart, with a purified mind, with a purified state in ourselves, so that we present ourselves before the Lord in the state in which he created. In which state he created? He created in by imbibing in him his light. And man is nothing but a purity of light. He flashes the illumination, and the illumination flashes through his eyes and mind and heart and his body, and he gets totally purified. This is what is the Sufism attempts to do. A Sufi is a person who wants to cleanse himself from the impurities which he has gained from the evolution, which he has gained from the elements which are within him. He wants to purify it to the state when he goes to the mind. There are three consciousness which is there. The highest consciousness of purity he attains. Which is the first consciousness? The first consciousness is, in Arabic it is, and the Quran refers as Nafse Ammara, that is the animal consciousness. We are a product of evolution. We are a product of evolution. All the characteristics of an animal, to capture, to eat, to drink, to lust, all these things are there. Then the moral consciousness which you have received from the training, from the civilization, the laws which you have received, the customs which you have received, the traditions which you have received. But along with this, we have received what is known as myth and mythology. This myth and mythologies are superstitions. A Sufi attempts to clear his mind and heart from these superstitions, from these myths and mythologies, and wants to go to reality. That is the Haq. Haq means truth. When he goes to the truth, he finds that he is nothing other than the speck of the great individuality and the great Lord himself. That is why in Hinduism, so far as concerned, that you are no other than you are a Atma, Paramatma, Atma and Paramatma, and you, when you have reached that highest stage, you will be considered as an avatar. And that is how the avatars have been coming. And Hinduism speaks about millions of gods having come into the world and gone. That is the purified stage. But Islam and Christianity doesn't want to give the status of a god to the man. Although Sufism contradicts and takes a sharper view, a view which is totally against the view expressed by the Islam of Christianity, in which it says that we, when we attain to the stage of highest consciousness of Nafs-e Mutmainna and Razia, that the consciousness of purity, of highest state, our mind and heart illuminates, and every speck of our body recites the name of the Lord. Hak, 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 hak. There is no Lord other than you. There is no Lord other than you. Oh my Lord, I am you, I am you, I am you, I am you. This is what Hallaj, the Mansur, the great Sufi, said, I am the Lord, I am the Lord, I am the Lord. When he said that, you, the Maulas and Maulanas and Mullahs said, you have committed blasphemy. You cannot be God. God is other than what you are. So he was beheaded. When it was beheaded, his blood spoke, I am Lord, I am Lord. They burned his body, the ashes spoke, I am Lord, I am Lord. They put him in the Dajla river rose, and all the other saints had to go and say, please don't destroy us. We did it as per law, the law of the command of the Lord. The Lord is the universe. He cannot be associate himself with anything of his own creation. He is other than the creation. He is hidden. The hidden treasure which is within us, you have realized, but you should not speak. You should keep your tongue tied, so that the Lord speaks through your action, through your eyes, through your mind. So this is what the great rishis have discovered, and this is what they have passed on to us from generation to generation. When we come to this plane, we find that the Sufism, mysticism, yoga are nothing but the same light which we are trying to find to ourselves in our mind and consciousness. Having said this much, I will read what I have written down so that it can make the whole paragraph a more understanding comes to it. What Sufism can offer and give to all of us, we are old age, we have not seen all this. We are something new is being spoken by Dr. Piran. We might have heard, we have lived a life of pleasure, we have been attached to so many things, to superstitions, we can't certainly change into God. What is it you are talking about, Mr. Piran? And give to those who have reached the true light zone and are in the evening of their life, after having felt the mirth and pleasure, the humdrum of their life. To quote a famous Sufi poet, Umar Khayyam, ah my beloved, now you will understand, the beloved is the Lord who controls us. Fill the cup of life that clears today of our past regrets. I did not do this, I did that. I should not have done like this. I did like this to my parents. I did like this to my children. This past keeps on hitting on the mind. The consciousness keeps on disturbing the mind. Past regrets and future fears, what will happen? Will my child will take care of me? Will anybody take care of me? What should happen to me? Where will I get my food? What happens if my BP goes up? My oxygen content comes down. This fear. Unborn tomorrow, dead yesterday, why fret about them and today be sweet? For a Sufi, each and every moment is precious. He lives moment by moment. He has no past, no future, no regrets, no morrows, no pain. The past and future are painful and full of regrets and fears. If you live for this moment and for now, you are thinking not of yourself, but you are filling your consciousness with love of your divine beloved, whom you have realized by shunning your ego, your inner eye, your ahankara, and merged your soul in the supreme eye, the Paramatma, the super consciousness. Your presence is a merger with your beloved, and a merger has brought pleasure immensely and deeply, and enlightenment, and opening of your inner eye. You have acquired self-knowledge and power of realization. Your every moment in the presence of your beloved is worth million hours of worldly existence. You do not wish to lose his divine presence of bliss and eternal happiness. Like Radha, being in the embrace of Sri Krishna, finding eternal divine love and fulfillment in the inner consciousness. When lovers mingle, the time has lost its meaning. Neither there is beginning
nor there is an end. Thus it is expressed in one of the passages of Holy Quran. That para is known as Laylatul Qadr. That is the night when Prophet is supposed to have had a merger with the Lord, and even when the Quran dawned on his mind and heart. The passage reads, "We have indeed revealed this message in the night of power, and what we'll explain to you what the night of power is. The night of power is better than 1,000 nights and 1,000 months. Therein came down the angels and the spirit of Allah's permission on every errand. Keys this until the rise of the morning." This is the passage. That moment of being in the divine presence is the most joyous moment. It is the merger and union. This is what a Sufi yearns for. He wishes to be always in the company of the beloved, in that eternal bliss and supreme love which fills the consciousness with divinity, with supreme satisfaction and enlightenment. He loses his personal identity. He attains moksha in his own life by breaking the path of karma and rebirth. When light dawns, there is enlightenment. Like Gayatri Mantra, keep on reciting it. Oh no, my mother, take away the darkness, enlighten my soul, give me the light in my heart. We keep on reciting it million times. When light dawns, there is enlightenment. The darkness disappears. The light eats away the darkness. There is glory and the fragrance spreads all over. Hence, the joy of union and merger destroys the past regrets and future fears. A Sufi feels that he is like a faithful dog. Why? Why so? In ancient Egyptian civilization, a dog was akin to God. Why so? Because a dog loses his identity with his master. He is at the master's beck and call. You call him Jimmy Jimmy, he wags his tail and comes running forever and ever without grouse or complaint. If he is chained, he remains in that position as long as the master wishes, day in and day out. If food is offered, he wags his tail. If denied, he does not bite the master, nor does he abandon the master. A dog identifies the friends and foes of the master. His loyalty is unquestionable. Sufi yearns to be like a dog. Certain people keep their names as Kalb-e-Sadiq, dog of the Sadiq, God is truth. They keep the name as Kalb-e-Sadiq, dog of the master, Sadiq, the truthful. People have in Muslim community, people keep their name themselves, "I am a dog of the truth." Sufi yearns to be like a dog to the master, always at the master's service, at the beck and call, without any complaint or grouse, always in joy, bliss and happiness, always in cheerful mood, feeling fully secure, without any fears, as he is in the master's presence. A Sufi's love is eternal, and his moments are ecstatic and joyful. A Sufi's mind is doubtless, absolutely doubtless, clear, crystal clear. With the master besides him, can the life is only a trifle, it just passes off. I'm always calling out my master, oh who, Allah, who, truth, you are before me, I'm nearer to your jugular vein, Lord says, I'm closer to you, I'm watching you, I'm keeping a watch, what is troubling you? I'll create associations, millions of my nightingale associations, I'll ask all my good people in the world, all my Mahatmas, all my Gurus to take care of you. Don't worry, I have the love of 90 mothers. I know what is crossing your mind, what is crossing your heart. A Sufi is convinced. That is the faith. That is what the Sufism says, teaches, that faith is the most important aspect and element. Without faith and without certainty that there exists the Lord and He is closer to me and He is watching me and He is taking care of me. If this faith and certainty is combined with gratitude, ahsan, that is, you always are grateful for all the pleasures you are getting. A momentary pleasure of a coffee, how it is enthralling, how exhilarating. In a moment, in such a bright sunlight, when things are being spoken of, great things, a little sip of coffee gives pleasure. That pleasure, Sufis say, you thank by calling upon the Lord, Alhamdulillah, praise be you, my Lord. This is what they say. A Sufi's mind is doubtless soul serene with the master besides him, life for him is trifle. The rudder of faith in master cuts off the turbulence of life. He realizes there is no meanderings, no confusion. The mind is at total peace. The shackles of iron or walls of brick cannot curb or prevent his pure and sublime love to his master. The Sufi realizes his master's grace grants him his effulgence, which leaves the Sufi in a trance. The Sufi's face radiates his master's glory, his beneficence, his might and mercy. The Sufi feels that his being is enveloped with the Lord's compassion. He feels that each particle of his body is his Lord's creation. He feels that his consciousness has merged with the master's, and the master's consciousness dwells in him, see sweetly, and the life dwells in him, and life glows in him sweetly and calmly. Songs flow from his lips in praise of the Master's love, which the Master showers on him eternally. A Sufi is totally surrendered being, and in this aspect of the surrender of a human being to the Master has been captured in a poem by me, which is Total Surrender. I read it. I love him, respect him, and honor him. Each breath of mine, because in the meditation, if you have learned, which you all do, when you take deep breath, you take the name of the Lord, Allah, or Guru, or whatever name which your Guru has given, and you leave your breath down by imagining him, thinking of him in his mind. When you're doing that, every breath is nothing but the breath of the Lord. Each breath of mine is spent in his service, day and night merge, and a slave forever, out of dedication and love of labor. Neither vagaries of weather, ill health, nor desires, nor slumber can deter me. With deep devotion, I burn the candle of my life at his feet in total surrender. I have no complaints, no demands, no compulsions, no grievances, no grief, no pain. Undoubtedly, I am captured by him. I am now left with no will of my own. My master's service, he is my main motto. I wish I were a dog to befriend him. And now, having known this much, the most important element of the Sufism is, as I have just now been speaking to you, is nothing but love. There is no hatred. Love and love and love. Mother's love is transformed with Lord's love. You see the mother, when you see Durga, you see the mother Durga is nothing but the personification of the deep love of the mother. I had the occasion to, as a lawyer, to conduct murder cases. And we had to interview the parents. The mother refuses, "No, my son is correct. He has not done. He can never do it. I know, I have given my blood. I have given my milk. I know my son." So your mother refuses to believe any sin that must have been committed by the... So that is why even the Lord says, "I am having the love of 70 mothers. Turn to me, I will give you my grace. I will give you my benediction. Come to me. Come to me as a repentant sinner. My doors are open to you always. Call me. I am nearer to you than your jugular nail. What is it that you want? I will give it to you." But what we need to get the fruit from the Lord is the sincerity and humility and the following and cultivating the truth in our beliefs, in our iman. In what we say through our tongue and your heart and your mind should be sincere and not hypocrisy. Hypocrisy is something which Lord says I don't like. This is what Sufism teaches, that you should be so sincere that not an iota of hypocrisy should come in your mind and heart. So with this aspect of love having been understood, I would like to speak about Sufi poems, which the great Mira or Kabir Das, Maulana Rum, great lovers of Lord who have attained great heights in the world, have put some of the aspects of love in the poems. And being a Sufi disciple from so many saints, they have spoken their love through my mind and heart. And their love is transmitted in my poetry, in Sufi poems. And a few of it I will place it before you for your kind consideration. "Let my soul gleam." You see, you must be aware that when people go to the temple or to the Kaaba, the first thing they imagine is that is the house of Lord or Lord himself. And I will circumambulate around thee. You must see the dog, how he wags the tail and keeps going round and round the master. Not for a biscuit, but it's something divine which makes him go round and round. This is circumambulation. "Let me circumambulate thee, sing pains, praise, pains is praise. Sing praise in love of you, like a moth, burn my wings in mad love forever. My eyes have wept and wept, slept little, sung thy praise, glorified heaven and cursed the Saturn, quenched longings, temporary desires. My every breath is charged, my every throb is grief. Open the doors to the yearning soul, embrace my spirit with both thy arms. O heaven, shelter this being with light and glory for soul to gleam. Now I have one more poem. You see, we have materialism. We have all that he has given. We have glorified our houses, our temples, our mosques, our churches, our dargahs, our everything. We want all glory to around us. And this is how a fakir is nothing but a totally dedicated mendicant in the Lord's life. He is a yogi. He has no wealth. He has no love for the wealth. Now, how does he feel when the wealth and magnificence of the Lord is translated in the form of glittering lights, chandeliers and woolen carpets, everything flowing? If you go to if anybody had occasion to see the TV of the holy mosques in Middle East countries, you would see huge chandeliers and woolen carpets and men in beautiful robes coming and with scents and perfumes. A fakir who has nothing in this world except his lungi or a scarf around him, how does he feel? The silvery dome, the glass chandeliers, the marble green, the woolen carpets, the muezzin's call and the faithful zeal, the echoing sound of the prayers around. My grieving spirit and bleeding heart, my shattered being and longings apart, my quivering lips and flowing tears, pangs of separation soul can't bear. My torn condition betrays me, my mourning is deep, none can see. Men in perfume dress detest me, I am pushed and pulled with all the glee. These are great fakirs. When they used to go to the temple or mosque, with their condition, torn condition, they used to be thrown out of the wall. And they would look at the Lord, "Oh Lord, why are you doing like this?" There are a number of instances, stories of the parables, when the great saints are supposed to have complained to the Lord for the way they have been treated by the humanity. It is God's wrath is supposed to have come immediately because he loves his lover. He doesn't bear it, and it's supposed to be earthquakes should come and destroy the mosque or the temple where such people are gathered. So he sings in the end, my poor heart is broken to pieces. Now I grieve and sing praises for thee. The Sufism, the Yogism, Yoga or Sufism or mysticism or these great cults of Zen, they all say that these miseries and these difficulties and these worries and all the pinpricks which comes to you is only to make you more love the Lord, to burn your candle inside you so that any desire other than the Lord in your mind and self is removed. There is no Lord other than you. I don't worship other than anything else. No, still you are having. So I'll give you some pinpricks. It is a mechanism which he has kept to instill in the mind and heart a divine love, a purified love, so that a pure heart reaches and receives the light of the Lord. The light of the Lord, when you receive it, you are a different individual, a different man, there are different women, there is a difference of millions. If Krishna was born by Kunti, you should realize it is Mother Lord himself giving birth to a mother. If Mary has given birth to Jesus, which according to the Christians is incarnation of Lord himself, you can understand the extent of the glory which the mother is carrying in her womb. She is glorified mother. So this is what a Sufi or a yogi or a mystic yearns for. And this he has put it after long meditation and roaming around, searching for him. And internally he finds the light. This he has put it in a point. I have roamed and roamed. My brother was saying, I have gone all over India in service. Now a Sufi moves from place to place. I have roamed and roamed in all four quarters of the globe and found to my dismay and grief that all the beauties are to wane. Take away all my treasures and wealth, my glories and achievements, my eminence, name and fame. Leave me alone with my soul's yearnings. My griefs are many and sorrows aplenty, with simple dwelling and humble living, but my soul's yearnings have never waned. My beloved's name is always on my lips. Let me sing pains for thee, send glories and praise for thee. A question arises as to why the feeling of merger, moksha, or a feeling of total devotion and total going deeply and merging, that is you are seeking death. Why are you thinking of death? God has given his glory, enjoy the moment, enjoy everything. But a merger is something which is more pure and more enlightening, because his God is going to the gods. He is reaching that stage. So the Sufi wants to put his last wish. He may be a young man, but still his growing inner self speaks through his tongue the last wish. To close my eyes forever and to breathe the last, to straighten the body, hands and legs, then let me sigh with thy name on my lips. Perhaps those who are here, whose children are away, when the phone rings up, you will say, "Oh Baba, is it you? Hey, what has happened to you? He must be working in some job at this hour, it is night time. Why are you thinking of him every minute?" That separation, you know, that gives that feeling. Why I should not think of my Lord, my son, my daughter, my grandson? That love. So it is the same love which makes a person sing his name whenever he thinks of him. And that is what he wants. That when one wants to shed his mortal coil, he wants the Hari's name. Oh Hari, oh Hari, oh Hari. Hari Ram, Hari Krishna, Hari Ram, Hari Krishna. Raghupati Raghava Raja Ram, Pati Tapavana Sita Ram, Ram Ram Jaya Raja Ram. How do you say, La Ilaha Illallah, Illallah? What's the difference? I didn't find any difference. It is the same breath, it is the same love, it is the same expression. You put it in Sanskrit, you put it in Arabic, it is the same thing which is in our consciousness, which is speaking again and again. I yearn for thy glance and a glimpse, for a reflection of thy effulgence, for your sweet fragrance and sweetness. Let me place my soul at thy holy feet. The holy feet is shown in the temples. People go and go down. It is the feet of the Lord, they say. But those who are monotheists, they say, no, don't think of it. But in the mind you are thinking. If not in reality, idol is kept. But mind is cannot escape. That you want some Lord with whom you want to place your bro. And the bro is kept there every time you go to namaz. It is whose bro, whom are you keeping your bro to, your forehead to? It is that Lord's feet. Oh, praise one, the deliverer of all souls. Let my tears of love be my humble gift. What can I give? I cannot give. What is the love I have? What present have you brought? Prophet was supposed to ask God. God was supposed to have asked him when he called him to the heaven. What gift have you brought? Normally we look when the guests come from abroad or everything, whether they have brought anything for us. At least I have brought some chocolate for you. The mother is so happy. I have brought a rose for you. And the rose is so... Why rose? Because it's fragrance. It embodies the love. It symbolizes the love. When a rose is presented, it is love which is being presented. I can't give you jewels, I can't give you diamonds, I can't give you rubies, but I can give you love, and love is nothing but a rose. Oh, praised one, the deliverer of all souls, let my tears of love be my humble gift. Let me present thee with my stricken heart, with its wounds and pangs of separation. Oh, my beloved, I yearn for thee all my life. Now I am immersed deep in your thoughts. This is what is merger. Merger is nothing but a deep feeling of love and affection for the mighty Lord who has taken care of every moment of our life, every situation of our life. As a lawyer I know, as a judge I know, how many cases are pending against people who have borrowed money, how they have been humiliated in courts, how they have to go to jail, how they have to suffer at the hands of the police by third degree methods, and how nothing. Today we are getting antibiotics which will take away all your illness in seconds. The injection pin is such that you don't even feel. This is the grace. This is the mighty grace for which I can only give my tears of love to you, O my Lord. So, what is this we should yearn for in our life? The Sufi says, purify yourself. Come. Let us fill our vacuums in heart and mind, in our souls, with love, affection and warmth. Illumine the mill with million lights of knowledge. Let us illumine our sagging spirits. We are so old, we are getting every day some pain, every day some torture, something new. Every day is a pain. What happens next minute? We are having fear. So this sagging spirits, the six which makes us sorrowful, depressive, let us illumine our sagging spirits with rhyme and rhythm, with melodies, with chords, and allow them to soar higher and higher like a skylark. Let us dwell deeper and deeper in the realms of the heart and bring out treasures to gleam our eyes and to enlighten ourselves. Let us purify ourselves afresh with the cool streams of love. So you know, we are all those who have studied mathematics or those in even simple knowledge. A zero is supposed to not have any value. We are millions and millions of zeros, no value. But all these zeros line up and stand before that great one. What has it gained? We become millions. So if you touch the magnet, you become magnet. So you say a magnetic personality. How you have developed magnetic body? Because you have been with the magnet. You are a glorious personality. How did you get the glory? You were very near to the glory. So this is what he wants to say in a poem. Zeros gain value. We are all millions of zeros, but all of us lining together besides that great one have gained a great value. That great one is all alone, but we millions of zeros, by praising and singing fans Hari Rama Hari Krishna, only that, nothing more, that for that one have gained glory. Many petals are held by a single stalk to form a beautiful flower, for nectar and fragrance to delight everyone with its beauty. Love emits sweet scent for everyone to enjoy its bliss. Self-expression is another poem of the same thought. The beauty of my beloved love, Lord, which wants to express itself. God wants to express himself. That is why you have so many birds with so many type of songs they sing, so many melodies which come into the mind and heart, so many ragas, those who are interested in music. Our veins are nothing but strings, and you touch that, you get that ragas. You just go into the rhythm and in the enchantment. Nothing but it is in your own self, this music is flowing. In your own self, that ordinary flute, which is nothing but a reed of a bamboo tree, it can sing in such a beautiful tones with the right rhythm and rhyme, which you cannot imagine at all. Who has given this? It is the Lord who wants to express himself through your tongue. Baat hoti hai unki, zubaan hilti hai meri. This is what I put it in Urdu poem. Baat unki hai, lekin meri zubaan hal rahi hai. Main nahi keh raha, wo keh rahe hai, wo kehna chahte hai. He wants to speak, he is speaking through me. He wants to give you, he wants to gift you, he wants to love you, he wants to embrace you, he wants to call you. Oh, come, what is your difficulty? Nightingale, I will give you anymore, anything. What do you want? I will give you. I will create any laws, anything for you, because I love you. This is what he wants to express. The beauty of my beloved Lord, which wants to express itself in million ways and methods in nature, there is brilliance. What uniqueness on this Mother Earth, the living and the non-living, the precious stones and the jewelry, the fruits, flowers, bees and insects. Every season has a wonderful fruits for so that meet the necessity of the man. Even before a child is born, the milk is ready for the child. The moment the child is born, its food is there. A milk which it does have no difficulty for a small child to digest. Hey, what a wonderful mechanism which Lord has kept. Do you think he will, after having taken care of 60 years, 70 years, protected you from so many bad, adverse remarks, given you promotions after promotions, given joys and beauties, will let you down at this hour when you want him and nothing else? No, he will not. Oh Lord, grant me the inner eye, that light to see through all things, to enlighten my mind and soul, to refresh my inner self every day. Let my faith in thee be steadfast, not lose my foothold to get lost forever. This is what is all about love. And I have written something about the inner aspects of Sufism. My time is up. Okay. I will give me permission to read one or two poems so that the thought gets completed. I hope so. I must to say.
We have some questions also.
Yeah, certainly you can. I will read out a prayer that we will end up with a prayer. Normally we start with a prayer. We end up with a prayer. I have two poems on prayer, which is what we yearn for. Prayer for tranquility. I keep telling my wife, don't tell me all these things. I want peace. I want to have only peace, salam. So I say prayer for tranquility. Oh, the praised one, the chosen one, the purified and the sublime soul, the cherished one, the protected one, the privileged one, the gracious one. How shall I please thee, O loved one, with my weary condition and wretchedness, with my chill penury and hollowed nature, with my empty head and dark soul? O the enlightened soul, the guided one, show me the path of enlightenment. Illumine my mind with million lights. Bring me ecstasy and supreme bliss. O my deliverer, O my redeemer, protect me on all sides and be with me. Let thy glimmer of hope cherish me. Let peace prevail and tranquility descend. And the last poem, with that I will conclude my talk, although much can be said for hours to hours, but we need to, we are not students of Sufism to learn. We are only for in person want to know what exactly is this. Lead me to light. O Lord, lead me to the light. For deep darkness surrounds me, doubt fears, blinded me with none to show the way that leads me to safety and your gardens. With thorny paths, marshy land, shallow pits, with bitterness, cruel way of tricky world, O Lord, I seek thy beaming light, for I am desolate, I yearn for thee. Storms and tempests, cyclones and lightnings, thunder, tornadoes with grave situations, fears abounding, with enemies surrounding, without any protection or help from anyone. O Lord, the beneficent and the merciful, show clemency, protect me, love me, love me. Thank you. No, he was a very pure Maulvi. But being a Maulvi, he shunned the aspect of religion, took up to celibacy, sat down in meditation. His master said he wanted to run away and sit in the jungle and do meditation. His master said, no, you should be in the town, remain among the people like a lotus in a marshy water, be above it, be above this, and serve mankind with your dictates of love, music. So Sufi, he was, his disciple Amir Khusru was a soldier as well as a great singer and inventor of guitar. So he gave audition, music, to love. Love was the something which said a lot can be understood to love and music. So a new thing we found was in Nizamuddin's poetry and his was introduction of music to understand ragas. Hindustani music were all, he was the master of it. His all his chelas were very great masters, Amir Khusru and others. So they all were divine people who did not want to have materials in a worldly way. So they are the saints of Islam.
Yes, sir. One question, if you are embarrassed, don't answer.
No.
In Pakistan today, will a Sufi
yes, I heard.
Will he be sort of boycotted?
Yes, that is what I had. What happened in the history, which I have written in a book also, is Islam and Sufism same? That is the answer to your question. What exactly happened was, when they found that the Sufi system developed all over the world, from India it went, Iran it went, Iraq it went, and from Middle East, Central Asian countries it went, and it went all over, and so many impure people also started taking advantage. Imposters, frauds, so-called babas and peers and others who had no knowledge, but seeing people going to them, they also put on the dress and wanted to make money. So the corruption came into Sufism. When corruption started coming into Sufism, a great scholar by name, Muhammad Abdul Wahab, he said, we must go back to the purity. This is what is Wahhabism. This Wahhabism started in Saudi Arabia 3 centuries ago. And his tribal people who followed him, they took up the sword, and the British and Americans gave them weapons so that they can find the Turks who are ruling the Makkah and Medina. So they captured Makkah and Medina. They have now brought in Wahhabism, and Sufism is thrown out. And with all millions of dollars and money and everything being spent all over the world, they want to purify the religion without Sufism. Sufism says there cannot be Islam without Sufism. Wahhabism says there cannot be Islam without you cannot be Sufis, you have to go on. So the Sufis are being persecuted. India is a heaven of spirituality. It has lived and it will live for ages. So it has protected, and its mother Durga gives birth to all. Come on, come in my shoulders, come and weep, it's for me. So in India, although there is every door, you will find every locality Wahhabism having spread. In every nook and corner, this is the effect of Wahhabism you are seeing. Millions and millions of people, money is being pumped in. they have taken up to arms, they have taken up to terror. The soul of Islam has already gone. When Prophet said, Sufism will come as a strange thing, it will disappear. When you find this thing happening, he gave exact dates also, that this man will be born. When he borns, this will happen. Then the wealth will come to my country and they will build huge towers which will touch the sky, and at that time the world will end. These are some of his prediction prophecies. So they have found that all which he had said against spirituality, which things will come, is happening today. And perhaps this is the one of the reasons why we find today nobody is taking to Sufism or yoga, or, and if it is done for wealth or for another purpose, then as a reality in life.
Even cricket is played
for money. Not a gentleman's game. Yes, sir.
On behalf of our Nightingale's Enrichment Center, and especially the group, we call ourselves as the Interfaith Group. We like to learn about other religions, and this is a session we are having on Sufism. Thank you immensely for coming forth to give us a lecture. This is our first lecture on Sufism. We are all novices at it. We hope you will take us to the sublime through Rumi and other saints, and we'll have other occasions to come. Since you are a close friend of Shaila's husband, we can take the liberty of inviting you over and over again. Please do come again and talk to us. It's the same yearning, because everybody yearns to merge with the Lord. So whether you have it in Hinduism or in Islam, it's the same yearning to merge with the Lord.
Thank you.